So this is the bag you use to climb up Everest?
Yes. Everest and Lhotse. This bag.
What did you carry in your bag?
When I climbed Everest, survival food such as candy and chocolate, and a thing like this to cover myself when it suddenly gets cold that protects the body from the wind.
What is the biggest challenge when you're up there in the heights of Everest?
Well, only Japanese may understand it, but I'm like a goat or something that likes high places. Someone like me enjoys being in high places.
So
you're saying you're a goat. What is it? I mean, people wonder, like, what could possibly drive somebody to want to take their life in their hands and do this climb?
When I think of it, I think it's because I like being in nature, and there aren't many people in high places, right? That's what makes me feel great.
How long will you be hiking?
I don't know at what age I'm going to stop, but if I do exercise every day, I think I can hike for another 10 years.
Maybe one more Everest climb?
No, I have done both of the routes up Everest. There are more mountains I have not climbed.
Can I see the lucky charm from the shrine? And what's the significance of this?
It seems to mean something about a historic shrine, but I don't know much about it. This charm protected me in Everest.
Let's talk about your first major climbing achievement. What was it and what did that feel like?
The first major mountain that I climbed was Mount McKinley in the U.S. in 1977. I climbed the south face of the mountain, or the so-called American Direct Route. I think that was my first introduction to climbing a major mountain. Also, the people I climbed with were all young guys. One was 6 years younger than me, and some were 12 and 13 years younger. I was the only middle-aged woman at 38 years old climbing with them. At one point, I was going to be a tent keeper at base camp, but the guy said, "Come on, let's climb. This is a route that no woman has ever climbed before." So I ended up climbing with them. I became the first woman to reach the summit, and I found this kind of mountaineering interesting. It was slightly different from the kind of mountaineering I had done before, and after this trip, I gradually became involved in climbing.
Can you name all of the famous mountains you've climbed?
Let me see. One was Dolagiri in Nepal, which I climbed with a group of seniors who were over 50 years old. Another is Gashabrum II in Pakistan. And let's see, Choi Oyu in the Himalayas, which was also 8,200 meters above sea level, if I remember. As I was climbing mountains higher than 8,000 meters, I learned to enjoy climbing these particular mountains too. And after climbing them, I was invited to climb Everest. And in the year following my climb on Everest, I climbed Lhotse that was adjacent to Everest.
Which is the most unforgettable climb?
Let's see. Well, they were all unforgettable. But Mount McKinley, where I had to climb many rocks, was a difficult route. So without that experience, I probably would not have been able to climb the icy rocks on Everest. So Mount McKinley was where I developed my skills to climb high mountains.
Let's go back to 2002, your very first trek up Everest, where you hit the summit at the very young age of 63. What was that climb like, and what was it like to reach the top?
For me, it's not a great achievement. What I thought was, I arrived at the summit. I did it.
You didn't realize at that time that you were going to be setting the record?
Well, I hardly thought about my own record. I was just enjoying mountaineering. Yeah.
While enjoying your trek, it's also a challenge when it comes to weather. Did you ever face any weather during your climbs up Mount Everest that you thought, this is really going to be very difficult, insurmountable?
There was a steep, hard wall of ice called the Lhotse face, which was about 100 meters long at a height of somewhere between 6,000 and 7,000 meters. I had to stand on my toes because I couldn't put my heels down, and I almost got cramps in my legs. I prepared myself for the worst and climbed to the top of the wall with all my might. Then I saw a group of 10 women from another country who were on the wall with quite unsteady footwork. It was the only time I tried to stay away from others, moving aside because I thought if one of them slipped and fell, everyone would fall together. So I moved to the side to avoid them.
We hear a lot about an area 1,000 meters above that called the death zone. It's that area where there isn't enough oxygen to sustain human life. What is it like to hit that level?
We climbed without an oxygen mask until up to about 7,300 meters. This was the same when we climbed Everest for the first time in 2002. The first night we were higher than 7,300 meters, we started using oxygen. When we continued onto higher ground, we put on our oxygen masks, so I stayed alert and was able to stay focused. I didn't feel that I was in danger.